Welcome. My name is Tim Sink. I am president of the Greater Concord Chamber of Commerce, and I wanted to thank you all for joining us today for what promises to be a very informative forum. We are really pleased to collaborate with AARP of New Hampshire. We've done collaborations like this in the past, and this provides a great opportunity for our collective members to become more informed voters. Special thanks to our candidates, Executive Councilors Colin Van Ostern and Chris Sununu, for including us in their very busy campaign schedules and making this event possible. I know they just did an event like this in Manchester last night, so they're hot on the campaign trail. At this point, it is my pleasure to introduce Todd Fahey, who is AARP State Director in New Hampshire. Todd is he's a friend, a colleague, and a little story about Todd. We were out on the lake water skiing, and I was really pleased with myself, showing off how well I could water ski and get in and out of the wake, and Todd complimented me on this, and then he jumped in with one ski, and I was put in my place rather quickly. So heck of a water skier. So please welcome Todd Fahey.
He promised no water skiing stories, but there's one. So thank you. Thanks, Tim. Thanks to Tim and the Concord Chamber, and a special thanks to Councilors Van Ostern and Sununu for coming today, because we know they're very busy. So you might ask yourself, why AARP in the chamber? And I'll just speak of it very briefly. Thousands of our 231,000 New Hampshire members are Granite State entrepreneurs, business owners, or employees. The issues that affect the 50-plus are social issues, and they are business issues. I repeat, social issues and business issues, given the outflight of millennials and an aging population. In a small business state like ours, we're pleased to work with the chamber to bring you programs like this. And the work that we do focuses on things like healthcare, support for caregivers. We have 173,000 in New Hampshire who do that kind of work without pay or without any compensation, sometimes with no recognition. We talk about transportation issues, and we work on financial security issues. We're also focused on building socially and economically vibrant communities for all ages, much like downtown Concord, because that's good for the people who live here and the businesses who call New Hampshire home and these types of communities home. So it is my pleasure, with that said, to introduce a familiar face to many of you. Our moderator today, he's an Emmy Award-winning former reporter, anchor, and political news director for WMUR in Manchester. It is my pleasure to introduce the very own Scott Spradling.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. I hope your bellies are full and that your eyes and ears are open for what I know will be a great exchange between our two major candidates for governor here in New Hampshire. Both are very familiar names. Both are people that I think you probably in this room have met a few times, may have some personal, political, and professional relationships that have been built over the years. We are fortunate to have two men who are running for this office, representing the two major parties, who are both articulate, who are intelligent, who have impressive resumes in both the business and political communities, and are running with their hearts and trying very hard to gain your vote. They have differences of opinion, which we can certainly flush out in a conversation, but they are both really outstanding representatives of their parties and working very hard to improve our state in the ways that they know how. So we're excited about this forum today and able to bring them up here in just a minute. Before I do so, let me introduce the two panelists who are going to be asking questions of the candidates. Representing AARP is Doug Dowell, who is of the Executive Council of AARP New Hampshire. Doug, come on up and take a seat. You can take either one, Doug. There's no rule here. And secondly, we have Phil Hastings, who's the Executive Committee, Chair of the State Government Affairs Committee, and President and Director at Cleveland, Waters, and Bass, representing the Greater Concord Chamber of Commerce. So, Phil, welcome. Before I introduce the candidates alphabetically, let me give you just a quick informal sense of how we're doing this. What we'll have is an opportunity for both opening and closing statements. I want to remind all of you that this is a forum and not a debate. While the question will be addressed to both candidates, and each will have time to respond, and Sarah Kelsey from AARP, Chris, and Colin so that you can see. Sarah's sitting right in front of me. She's going to be our timekeeper, and she'll do sort of like informal hand gestures. I think she'll sort of raise her hand when we're getting close to a time frame and maybe a little bit of the cut time when the time is up. So you can follow that. But this is meant to be a forum, an exchange of ideas, and not necessarily a head-to-head debate. The organizers have given me a little bit of leeway to ask follow-ups and allow for maybe more information in case we run out of time on some of these broad stroke questions. And of course, if there is something said by one of the candidates that the other really wants to respond to, I will absolutely allow that. But at the same time, this is really meant to be a forum and an exchange of ideas with all of you. And so we will allow the conversation to unfold that way. Basically, 1 minute answers is what we're going to be doing here through the course of the day, with 2 minute opening and closing statements. I have promised Tim Sink that no matter what happens, we will all be out of here by absolutely no later than 1:30, and quite possibly earlier than that, so that we can all get on with our own days and our professional and personal lives. So without further ado, I will introduce alphabetically. First, Executive Counselor Chris Sununu. And now it's my honor to introduce Executive Counselor Colin Van Ostern.
Hey, how are you?
All right, so by a coin flip that we did just a few minutes earlier, and I have to admit and apologize, it was not a New Hampshire quarter. I had a Minnesota quarter, so I totally screwed that up. But with that said, by coin flip, we have determined who will be the first and the last speaker. So, Councillor Van Ostern, you have 2 minutes for an opening statement.
Well, thanks very much, Scott, and thanks to both the Chamber and the AARP for bringing us together, and welcome to my home here in Concord. For those of you I'm meeting for the first time, my name's Colin Van Ostern. I'm running for governor because I know that our state is ready to take its next step forward. I know that as a dad. I have two young boys whose future means everything to my wife, Kristen, and I. One of them just started at Kristen McAuliffe School about a couple weeks ago, which is a great school. Thank you to everyone who has contributed to this extraordinary community that we live in. And I've worked as a business leader at great New Hampshire employers, places like Stonyfield Yogurt and Southern New Hampshire University. At SNU, I helped launch College for America, which is a nonprofit accredited degree program that is now helping thousands of working adults get a college degree, usually an associate's degree, usually with no debt, including great employers right here in Concord who've helped their working adults get a degree, places like Concord Hospital and Northeast Delta Dental. It's critical because strengthening our workforce is one of the ways that we need to grow. And for the last 4 years on the Executive Council, I've worked hard to put that private sector business experience into making sure that our state government runs with less red tape, with no sales tax, no income tax, that we're efficient in our state spending. There are projects here in the Concord community like the Sewell's Fall Bridge, which just a year and a half ago, the mayor and the city manager came to me because they were worried we were going to lose a construction season because of the red tape and bureaucracy between city and state officials. And I rolled up my sleeves and helped get that back on track, or worked hard to make sure that the Merrimack Courthouse is being built downtown here in Concord. I know as a state that we need to build our future by bringing and keeping young people and young families and new businesses and startups here. And I also know that part of that means as our population ages, we need to ensure that everyone from every age and stage in life has the opportunity to fully participate in our communities and in our economy. And I hope that the next hour will be a conversation about some of the ways that I think we can do those things. I look forward to the conversation. I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much.
Councillor Van Ostern, thank you. Councillor Sununu, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. And again, it's great to see everybody here. A nice crowd on midday. I like to think you came for something other than the lunch, but the free lunch, but we all probably know better. Look, New Hampshire's a great state. It is a great state. I've never wanted to say the sky is falling, but we can and we must do better for our families, the communities, the businesses that power our economy. This is where we need to put our focus. I'm a big believer that we need a governor in this state that isn't afraid to make a little change, that understands how policy really impacts people's lives, that's a stakeholder. I'm running because of my background. I started out my career as an engineer, a civil and environmental engineer. I cleaned up hazardous waste sites all over the country, worked on green energy projects. I run my business now up in the White Mountains. I manage Waterville Valley Resort. I have 800 employees up at Waterville Valley. So when we're talking about things like business, for example, business taxes, overregulation, healthcare costs, our lack of energy policy, these are issues I deal with and live and breathe with my, what I call my second family up there, every single day. And I can tell you exactly how these policies out of Concord are truly impacting people's lives. I talk a lot about education. I'm very passionate that we need to really refocus and revisit how we handle education in the state. I say it again, as a dad, I have a fifth and a sixth grader. Whether you're talking about Common Core, school choice, which I believe very, very strongly in. We need a governor that's a stakeholder that understands these issues from a classroom perspective, from a parent's perspective. Really having someone that is a stakeholder, I think, can make all the difference. Over the past 20 years, to get a little political, I believe Democrat governors have erased that New Hampshire advantage, right? We have this New Hampshire advantage. It's been erased. Washington bureaucracy, Washington regulations, higher business taxes. We talk about having a younger workforce in the state and the problems we have driving a younger workforce here. When was the last time we brought a major business into this state? Right? New Hampshire used to be that shining example where people would flourish into. We're having a hard time. And with my business leadership being able to go and bring these businesses across the state lines, understanding what they need to see, that's the type of stakeholder, that's the type of perspective and experience we really need in the corner office to make changes. And understanding where we're going forward as a state, demographically, with our age, with our population, we need to make bigger steps, we need change, and I hope to bring it to the corner office. So again, great to see everybody, and let's have a fun discussion.
Thank you, Counselor. We'll start with moderator questions. And just before I do, a friendly reminder from all of you, there's still time for you to jot down a couple of questions. If inspiration strikes, do it. You can just raise your hand because we have folks in the back of the room trained to look for that. And I have a few already, so we can bring them up even during the course of the process. But first, let's start with our co-presenter from AARP, Doug Dowell, with the first question directed to Councillor Van Ostern.
Subject matter is caregiving in the Granite State, especially respite care. Question is, what would you do to improve access to respite care so that more family caregivers can take a break from their caregiving duties and continue their caregiving responsibilities?
Thank you. It's a great question, and it's particularly critical as some of the news that we've seen in recent days that not only does New Hampshire have the second highest median age in the country, but by 2040, we'll see an extraordinary portion of our population living over the age of 65. The truth is that when we help folks stay independent in their own homes or in the home of a family member, we not only often help ensure that they have a better life, but also that we keep costs down. Institutionalized care is often the most expensive care. And that's why I think we need to make sure that those who are caring for a loved one and their family in home-based care have every opportunity to do that, and that we help ease some of the financial burdens that they face. There's an idea in front of the legislature right now which would provide a tax cut for home caregivers that I think holds a lot of merit. It would be a tax credit against the statewide property tax. There's a federal tax credit for dependent care right now, but we can do more as a state, and we'll actually save money in the long run if we enable people to help care for loved ones in their homes and save money that otherwise would be spent on institutional care.
Councillor, thank you. Would you mind repeating the question for Councillor Sununu?
Subject matter is caregiving in the Granite State, especially respite care. And the question is, what would you do to improve access to respite care so that more family caregivers can take a break from their caregiving duties and continue their caregiving responsibilities?
It's a great question. And as Colin brought up, the demographics are staring us right in the face. We have a silvering population. Some people say graying. I say silvering population. That means a couple different things. We have more folks that are going to be on fixed incomes as we pass the years along, so to say. The quality of care, quality of life issues are always better when you have home caregiving, respite caregiving. And I'm going to refer back to the budget. Let's talk about what we just achieved. The Republicans in the last budget gave the first raise to to home caregivers in 10 years in this state. And that budget was vetoed and supported by the, not supported, but vetoed by the Democrats, by Governor Hassan. So for 3 months, she sat there vetoing a budget when the Republicans insisted on giving a raise to home caregivers. That's not leadership. The problem I have with what happens out of Concord is too often we're deferring to the Washington answer, big bureaucracy. You'll never convince me that Washington, D.C. has New Hampshire's best interests in mind. They don't. They simply don't. Doing things New Hampshire's way with New Hampshire's interests in mind is the best way to do it. We've had success last year. Thank goodness she finally signed that budget last year. And we're going to keep having success by making sure that we invest those dollars because the return is so much greater when you have that respite in home care.
Thank you, Counselor. Not sure what that sound was next door. They're having a lot of fun.
That was a cheer. That was the cheer for my answer.
Why don't we move to the next question, and questioner Phil Hastings, who is representing the Chamber of Commerce today. Phil, you can direct your question first to Councillor Sununu.
Councillor Sununu, as you know, New Hampshire has one of the highest utility electric rates in the country. Considering that manufacturing is critical to our economy, and those manufacturers are large energy consumers, this puts us at a serious disadvantage in terms of business recruitment and retention. What measures do you support to reduce power cost?
Great question. So there's a couple important issues here. We need a lot more drops in the bucket when it comes to our New England energy market. My electric bill at Waterville Valley 2 years ago was $1.2 million. $1.2 million. So when I see, exactly as the question is referencing, manufacturers leaving the state because we don't have a viable long-term energy plan, I understand it. I'm living those issues with them day after day. I'm a stakeholder in it. But let me tell you what the difficulty, obviously, is bringing more manufacturers in. We're losing them in droves. But you know what other high energy rates mean? Those on fixed incomes, as we have a larger senior population, they will not have the financial flexibility in their lives because all their dollars are going to go to paying our high fuel costs, our high electricity costs. I'm supportive of projects like Northern Pass. Northern Pass will save the state 80 ratepayers, not just the state, $80 million a year. That is one piece of the pie. That's about 5-6% off everybody's bill in this state, right? And the idea that we're going to bury the whole line, that's not going to happen because that would make the whole project uneconomical. Why add $1 billion to that cost? We need to get more fuel into the state. We need more flexibility in how we manage our energy. We need to make sure we're putting those other drops in the bucket, like more natural gas, more renewable energy projects, things like that that, again, we can all benefit from.
Thank you, Counselor. That was probably about a minute and a half, so Councillor Van Ostern, you can have a minute and a half to answer this question. I know there's a lot to it.
Well, it's an important question. Thank you for offering it. I've seen it managing $100 million P&L at Stonyfield Yogurt. Most people don't think of Stonyfield as a manufacturer, but we manufacture cups of yogurt and quarts of yogurt. And I know that energy, like any other market, really prices are about supply and demand. We need less demand through more investments in energy efficiency. And we need more supply. I believe the best way to do that is through clean and renewable projects like solar and renewable energy projects that I have fought hard for all across the state. To be clear, this is a big difference between Chris and I. We've sat next to each other on the executive council for the last 4 years, and repeatedly he has voted against almost every solar energy project that's come in front of us, including the biggest one in the state in Peterborough, the second biggest that I was at just a few days ago in Durham. We need to be investing in clean and renewable energy projects, not trying to hold ourselves back. Here's an example as to why. 10 years ago, Stonyfield put the biggest solar array in the state at the time on the roof of their yogurt plant. 10 years ago, it would have taken 300 of similar sized arrays to power that plant for a year. Today, the biggest array in the state is 20 times bigger, which means it would take 15 solar arrays to power the plant for a year. But within the next year or two in New Hampshire, we will be building solar projects that could, one single array could power the entire plant at Stonyfield for a year. Now, that level of technology investment means that we're bringing down costs, we're creating local jobs, and we're protecting the environment, which is critical to our natural resources in a state where tourism is our second biggest economy.
Let's be clear. Let's be clear. You know, leave it to the Democrats to lecture an environmental engineer on renewable energy. I used to design these systems. I have supported way more projects than we've said no to. But let me tell you the benefit of saying no to bad projects. When Manchester wants to spend $4 million to build a solar array so they can save $26,000 a year, with no benefit to taxpayers and no benefit to ratepayers. Does that make sense to anybody? That's a bad project. Why don't we invest that $4 million in more projects that are more efficient, more hydro, more solar, rooftop solar that can directly affect individuals? By having the experience and the judgment of knowing the economic, social, or environmental impacts, we can make better decisions and invest our money wiser in more renewable energy projects. That's leadership.
Councillor, maybe 30 seconds, and then I'll ask a follow-up question on this.
Yeah, I mean, I think folks can look at the record. Many of the votes Chris took, actually, it was a 4-1 vote, meaning a bipartisan support in the majority of the Executive Council for solar projects like the biggest in the state in Peterborough, or ones in Durham or Portsmouth or Plymouth or Manchester, or a great locally supported wind project in Berlin. Over and over again, he has voted against more, I think, than any politician in the state of New Hampshire's history voted against solar and renewable energy projects. I think that holds our state back and holds our economy back. And I'll be a governor who helps New Hampshire takes the next step forward, and clean and renewable energy is an important part of the equation to do that.
So let me ask a follow-up. And Councillor Sununu, I'll start with you, but it's for both of you. So we've just charted out a conversation around renewables, around solar, around hydro. One of the realities of our current energy grid system is that many of us are getting our power through natural gas. Not that there is a proposal sitting in front of us right now, but given our region and our state's reliance on natural gas, what is your sort of philosophical approach to any future discussion about expanding natural gas here in the state and in the region?
Sure. Councilor? No, we definitely need to expand it. We need to expand it the right way. I was very critical of the gas project that was recently proposed through the southern part of the state, primarily because they just kind of dropped a big project on this state. They didn't do their job going town by town, community to community, talking to them, getting their input, making sure we understood what the impacts were, getting that feedback so they can design the best plan for us. As governor, I will champion those projects, but I'll make sure we do it the right way, town by town, person to person, not just letting the federal government drop a big project on us. And it's not just natural gas. It is more renewable. And again, with my judgment, my discernment, we can have more money for more efficient renewable projects. I will not be a rubber stamp for every project that comes across my desk. By all means, if you want the rubber stamp, Colin is absolutely your choice as governor. I'm going to use discernment and judgment for all the different projects across the state to bring more power in, and let's increase competition, reduce the prices.
Councillor, thank you. Councillor Van Ostern, the question about natural gas and your philosophical approach to that idea.
Well, I have a few concerns when we're making long-term infrastructure investments that increase our reliance on fossil fuels. My concern about the particular proposal, the NED pipeline, really had to do primarily about the economics of it. If we're going to be making large investments like that, I'd always love to see how we can do it more in clean and renewable energy projects. The truth is that technology always gets better, and fuel tends to get more expensive and more volatile and more dangerous and harder to get. But to that specific project, I had a lot of concerns, and I still do, that the cost of building a natural gas pipeline were going to be shifted over to have electric ratepayers who don't use natural gas pay the cost of it. That's the sort of economics that doesn't work for New Hampshire, and that's why, as it was happening, I didn't sit on the sidelines and complain about it. I went to the scoping hearings and stood up and explained why I thought there were outstanding questions that needed to be addressed before we could move forward with it.
Thank you. Let's move back to the panel now. Phil, let's come back to you, and you can pose your question for both candidates, and we'll start with Councillor Van Ostern. And you speak into the mic so everyone can hear you.
Thank you very much. Councillor Van Ostern, New Hampshire's unemployment rate is near 3%, which is essentially full employment, and businesses are struggling to find qualified workers. What is your plan to ensure that New Hampshire has an adequate labor force going forward?
This is an area I'm personally passionate about. I mentioned College for America. When I left Stonyfield, I helped launch a workforce development college. At the time, there were about a dozen employees, no paying students, a promising pilot project. And the goal was to work directly with employers to help their working adults get a degree so they could move up in their job and their career. Our typical student is a woman in her early 40s who's earning an associate's degree, often who will get promoted multiple times while in the program, and that's one of the best ways that we can strengthen our workforce. There's similar ways we can do that in the public sector. Governor Hassan has proposed something called Gateway to Work, working directly with many employers in the state who've been advocating for this. This is a program that, as our unemployment is low, and the federal government is sending us what otherwise would be welfare dollars, TANF dollars, instead of saving it for public welfare, We use it now for job training so that someone who's working as a greeter at Walmart can get a certificate or an associate's degree, become a medical assistant or a patient navigator, start providing a better life for themselves and their family, and never need welfare at all. Unfortunately, it has been hung up in politics. In fact, since May, it's been stuck in a legislative committee. The next step would be to come to the Executive Council. I would today ask legislators who have held it up to bring it forward to us. There's nothing partisan about this. I'd hope that Chris would join me in that request. I think if we had strong bipartisan support and a request to the Legislative Fiscal Committee to bring it forward to the Council, we'd help our employers tap into the workforce that they need today.
Thank you, Counselor. Phil, could you repeat your question for Councilor Sununu? And you have 90 seconds, sir.
Yes, New Hampshire's unemployment rate is near 3%, which is essentially full employment, and businesses are struggling to find qualified workers. What is your plan to ensure that New Hampshire has an adequate labor force?
Well, again, I'm right there with those businesses. I have about 800 employees over the course of the year. We're having trouble finding qualified workers, especially up in the North Country. People have to remember what happens kind of Concord South is very different than what happens in the North Country. And having a governor that has this type of perspective, have real world experience dealing with these issues is going to be important. Let's talk about three things that I'm going to do. My plan says that when you graduate from a New Hampshire university, and you come out, if you stay in one of our job areas where we're having trouble filling, like let's say psychiatry or teachers or nurses, we're going to help pay down your student debt because we have some of the highest debt. Let's help those families and incentivize young people to stay here and work. I'm a big believer in career schools. Those are, we call them the old voc schools, right? The new generation of career schools are terrific. We have one in Exeter, the Seacoast School of Technology. I have asked the governor and the council to come over and visit that facility with us in 2 weeks from now, which will be exciting. Our kids are leaving high school, we have to make sure they have workforce-ready skills on day one, whether it's in nursing or agriculture, electricians, carpenters, whatever it might be. Getting them to graduate is great and it's noble, but let's make sure that they can enter that workforce if need be on day one. The other piece that I believe, we have a lot of our workforce, given our drug crisis right now, we have a lot of able-bodied folks that are limited. My plan looks at business tax credits for businesses who invest in job training programs as you come out of a recovery center. So we're not saying goodbye and good luck to those who are fighting addiction. We're actually getting them trained skills and getting them back into the workforce. So again, it helps with their recovery. It helps retain viable workers for the future.
Counselor, thank you. A follow-up for both of you. You've both talked about the connection between education and businesses. How do we strengthen that? Because it's a conversation that I think all of us in this room have, at some level, participated in and pushed for a number of years. And it seems like it's kind of pushing the boulder up the hill, if you will. Counselor Van Ostern, how do we improve that pipeline to connect our schools, our higher education system, to the businesses that are trying to find these folks today? How do we improve that?
So that, at its core, is the model that we built College for America on. There, we work directly with more than 100 employers today. In fact, we enrolled over 4,600 new students last year. That's as many as UNH and Dartmouth combined. 70% are the first in their family to go to college, 70% getting a degree with no debt at all. And one of the keys was working directly with employers, whether it's Goodwill or Anthem Blue Cross Blue Shield or Delta Dental or Concord Hospital. They see a lot of the value, both in being able to pay some of the costs, but also in making sure that the curriculum is based on competencies that are needed in the workforce. It's incredibly important that the skills our students are getting allow them to be workforce ready from day one, and unfortunately that often hasn't been the case. Some of the ways we can apply that to our public university system in New Hampshire, we need to acknowledge two things. First, that we fund our university system lower than any state in the country, and so it's not a surprise that our in-state tuition and student debt are the highest in the country. But second, you can't just throw dollars on it without accountability. And I believe that it's not just enough to help folks pay down their student debt. You have to lower costs in the first place. The way to do that is to make sure that any additional funding comes with requirements around what the student debt levels will be cut to, goals around having students get jobs here in New Hampshire, graduation completion rates. Most states in the country have accountability measures like that. We need to move in that direction here in New Hampshire.
Counselor, thank you. Counselor, your answer to building that relationship, you have 90 seconds.
Absolutely. Let's talk about what I've done. So on the Seacoast, for example, Great Bay Community College, Will Arvello, the president. I went in, I sat with Will. I also went in and sat with the head of SIG Arms, Ron Cohen, who said that he was having trouble finding folks in his manufacturing facility. So we went and we put those folks together. And what's the result? Now we have programs directly in Great Bay Community College that are training directly to the skills needed for a manufacturer literally a mile away. It's great. It's a perfect avenue right through the system. Another example would be some of the auto dealers. We brought some of the auto dealers into these career schools to make sure that you know, when you're learning to be an auto mechanic, it's not just changing the oil anymore. It's really having the high-tech skills, the computer skills, and knowing not just working on the old 1976 Chevy Nova, but working on the more modern cars, having those skills so, again, when they leave the career schools, let's say if they're in the automotive department, they can go right in to not just a base-paying job, but a mid-range or even a higher-paying job right in to those auto companies. So again, I've been working for years building those relationships, making sure that we have that connectivity, and we have to keep doing that across the state.
Thank you, Counselor. Let's go back over now to Doug Dowell, representing AARP, for the next question, and that can go to first Counselor Sununu.
Counselor Sununu, the subject matter is enhancing retirement security, specifically putting retirement security in reach. Today, 43% of residents in our state don't have a way to save for retirement at work. Knowing that employees are 15 times more likely to save merely by having access to payroll deduction, what can you commit to do to reverse the trend of under-saving for retirement above and beyond education efforts?
So, great question. Again, I'm dealing with it in my business. So let me tell you some of the things that I see that have become very problematic. When you have incredibly high business taxes, when you have a state that has done virtually nothing to get control of their health care costs, when we have incredibly high energy costs, all of these costs that businesses, manufacturers, small and large are dealing with every single day, these are preventing those businesses from having more financial flexibility to help their employees. I mean, we've created a system in the state where we're not incentivizing more people into the private health care, we're incentivizing more people into a public health care system, which just drives up the costs. And that public health care system has gotten more and more expensive, on the private side of things. We need to give businesses the financial flexibility, the regulatory flexibility to do what they do best, run their business. I'm a big believer government has to get out of the way. And when you do that, you can get businesses to allow themselves to build better plans for their employees, better plans for retirement. We need to make sure, and supporting the pension, I was just gonna add my 2 cents on the pension fund, making sure that we have viable pension funds in the state, and we are, again, committing to the promises we make to retirees in those pension funds.
Counselor, thank you. Counselor Van Ostern, you have 90 seconds.
Thank you. New Hampshire led the way nationally with something called the Unique College Savings Plan about 15 years ago now. It's called the 529 Savings Plan. There's not just one of these. Folks can get any private savings plan for college to save tax-free that they like. But the state realized that if it put out to a competitive bid and partnered with, in this case, Fidelity Investments to provide an easy vehicle for folks to be able to save, that there could be some gains through large volume and folks doing it together. A portion of the administrative fees actually has gone to help scholarships for New Hampshire students, and it's completely voluntary. And I think there's an opportunity here in private retirement savings as well for the following reason. A big company like Southern New Hampshire University with thousands of employees, or a decent sized one like Stonyfield with hundreds of employees, often has enough HR staff to sort through all the different retirement plans and options and provide a payroll deduction system. But a small mom and pop, like some of the ones that we worked with at College for America, often doesn't have dedicated staff to do that. And so I think that having a state facilitated, though no state funding, a way for folks to be able to ensure that a retirement plan is tax-free, is from a responsible organization, that as we do it in volume, that a portion of the cost can be used to help strengthen our workforce for our aging population in the state. That's the sort of model that I think is worth exploring here in New Hampshire.
Thank you, counselors. Let's stay with Doug for another question from AARP, and you can address this one first to Counselor Van Ostern.
Counselor, the subject matter is Medicaid expansion.
Yes.
Now that New Hampshire has expanded Medicaid through the New Hampshire Health Protection Program, how will you protect hardworking Granite Staters' access to affordable health coverage through the New Hampshire Health Protection Program when it comes up for renewal in the future?
Well, this is very straightforward. There was a 3-2 vote on the Executive Council to implement it. I voted yes, Chris voted no. I've said I think we need to make it permanent. He said he thinks we need to end it. He tends to use the word grandfathering because it's more polite than end it, but I think we all know what grandfathering means. The truth is the New Hampshire Health Protection Plan has been a huge bipartisan success. 50,000 of our fellow citizens get access to health care now. most through private plans because of that. We did it without raising a single state tax. 27% fewer people showed up uninsured in our ERs last year as a result. And this is critical. Thousands of our fellow citizens are getting drug and addiction treatment services through the successful New Hampshire Health Protection Plan. We need to keep that going, not end it. And the fact is that if Chris had won that vote, if it had been 2-3 instead of 3-2, thousands fewer today would have gotten addiction treatment services, would have had health care coverage, more people would be showing up uninsured at our ERs, and I think that would be holding our economy back.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Let's be very clear. The Executive Council has never taken a vote, a thumb up or thumb down on Medicaid. It's appalling to actually hear this. I've never advocated for cutting 50,000 people off of expanded Medicaid rules. Expanded Medicaid does great work for us. Let's be very clear. There have been 4 votes taken by the Executive Council on funding expanded Medicaid. I approved the first, the second, the third, and I was very much in favor of the fourth. The vote that Councilor Van Ostern is referring to was a vote on a $292 million contract that we received 20 minutes before the vote. He and the governor even admitted they had not read the contract. All I said was, well, we have to read it. Let's take the vote in a couple weeks. Nope, we can't. We have to pass it now. We can read it later. That's exactly what they said. So when I stood up and said, well, I'm not going to vote on a $292 million contract I didn't read or the people didn't read, would anyone do that other than maybe Nancy Pelosi and Colin Van Ostern? Absolutely not. And to try to score some political points and imply that I'm against expanded Medicaid is an absolute lie. It really is. I'm very supportive of the program that we have in place. Councilor Van Ostern wants to make it permanent. Well, you know what you do when you make federal government programs in this state permanent? You lose all your leverage. You lose your ability to control costs, ability to push back, ability to make those programs done the New Hampshire way. I believe in doing it our way. I believe in having flexibility. If we need to keep expanded Medicaid going for a couple more years, sure, I'm very open to that, to be very clear. Do not misrepresent, it drives me crazy when people try to misrepresent my record on that. I've been very clear about it. But I will not just be a rubber stamp that passes contracts without reading them, ever.
Colin, Counselor, would you like a moment to respond?
Yeah, certainly some of the things that Chris said are just factually not true, and you can go back and check the record. But I would encourage you to take him at his own words. In this primary campaign, he went on a talk radio show and said he fought hard to make sure this never even got to the Executive Council. He voted against it. If you don't think that vote matters, look at a vote where he did win. A 3-2 vote, just like that, on a different contract when he successfully voted to shut off Planned Parenthood funding in our state. For 10 months, hundreds fewer women were able to get birth control and cancer screenings and annual exams. In Manchester, waiting lists went from 3 to 5 weeks. These votes matter. This is an election where the future of our state will be determined by whether we're going to take something that was a bipartisan compromise, a work from Democrats and Republicans who came together in a New Hampshire way that didn't raise state taxes, and continue it? Or are we going to elect somebody who fought against it repeatedly, bragged about fighting against it, and has said, in fact, go to his campaign website right now. It says that he wants to repeal the Affordable Care Act. That is how we have had the New Hampshire Health Protection Plan work in New Hampshire. That would be holding our state and our economy back, and I know that for our future we need to do better than that.
Councilor, thank you. Councilor Sununu, I want to give you a chance, and I also want to sort of, as a follow for part of your answer, where are the areas that we can strengthen and improve, and what needs to be changed as you've looked
at this
plan?
Well, again, let's talk about the Planned Parenthood contract. That contract has come before the Executive Council 5 times, and I voted for it 4 of those times. Again, the only time I voted against it, I've stood up against my party. I mean, my record on this has been plastered all over the place. Me standing up against my party, against some very strong conservatives, folks even in my own family, because at the end of the day, women's health care is what mattered to my constituents. And I stood up and fought for it. The only time I said no is last year we saw those horrible videos. And I said, Governor, let's do an investigation and make sure the group in New Hampshire isn't doing that. I didn't believe they did. They were. And let's just clear the air so we can move forward. She refused. So I said, while these questions are hanging out, while we have 10 investigations across the country going on, again, it's about process. It wasn't about policy. It's about doing right by the people in New Hampshire, making sure who we're doing business with. And as soon as all those investigations got cleared up, I said, great, we can move forward with a clear conscience, and I supported it. And I didn't look at the politics of it. I knew it could be the end of me politically. I didn't look at what it meant to me personally. All I cared about was making sure the women of my district, those low-income women and families, had health care services. I put myself on the line. We got it done. It's exactly what I've done as counselor, and it's exactly what I'm going to do as governor.
Counselor, thank you.
So, Scott, I just want to clear up a couple facts on the Planned Parenthood funding. The reality is that had real direct harm. It's not about process. It's about people. There are hundreds of women and families who had a harder time getting access to birth control and cancer screenings. This is not abstract. This is about people's lives. It weakens all of our communities. It weakens our workforce. It weakens our state when we let politics get in the way. And the truth is that even after all of those investigations, which, let's be honest, there will always be someone trying to launch a new investigation to try to stop women from getting access to the health care that they need. But even after all of them were done, in January of this year, Councillor Chris Pappas and I wrote a letter to the other councillors, and the next day on the front page of the Portsmouth Herald, Chris said he stands by his decision to defund Planned Parenthood and he won't budge because they're, quote, a bunch of bullies. These are women who lost access to health care in some cases. They're not a bunch of bullies. They're our fellow citizens. I think part of what's important for our next governor is that we're able to look past the politics, look past the Washington talking points, find ways that we can work together to strengthen our
I absolutely never called women in the state bullies. This is what we're talking about here. And when the contract came before the council, we voted on it, and I voted for it. I voted for this contract 4 out of 5 times. The fact that you're trying to score political points is unconscionable. I've stood up strong. Everybody knows it. Democrats, independents, Republicans. And I'll keep doing it time and time again.
Councilors, thank you for a spirited exchange. I'm going to bring it back to Phil Hastings, representing the Concord Chamber. And he will ask the next question of Councillor Van Ostern.
I'm almost certain this will not rise to the level of spiritedness. As governor, what would be your top priority relative to infrastructure improvements, and how would you address it?
It's a great question. When we talk about strengthening our workforce, one of the importance of bringing in keeping young people and young families and new businesses and startups in our state is that we need to have more people participate in our economy, and workforce infrastructure is a great way to do that. I wish I could give you one that's above all others, and I'll have to say probably it would be finally getting I-93 expansion done. This has taken too long. It unlocks tremendous growth for our state. There are also related projects like Exit 4A or the Pettingill Road area around the Manchester Airport, not far from the Stonyfield plant, actually, where we've seen businesses already grow because we've started to increase infrastructure in those areas. But frankly, I don't think it can be one. I think we also need to look at expanding access to our digital infrastructure, rural broadband, particularly important to seniors, but in our North Country and the southwestern part of the state. I think we need commuter rail from Boston to Nashua to the Manchester Airport and the Mill Yard so that we can help our companies grow who are desperate for accessing a larger workforce. I'll tell you, I-93 expansion is the number one, but there are some number 2, 3, and 4 that are very important too.
Councillor, thank you. Councillor Sununu, top three infrastructure.
Look, leadership is about priorities, making difficult decisions at tough times. We have 153 red listed bridges, must get taken care of. We have 2,000 miles of road that are in poor to very poor condition, must get taken care of. I-93 being completed, the Sarah Long Bridge getting done. Those are the needs of the state, and they must be addressed. And I shudder when I chuckle a little bit when I hear Councillor Van Ostern's answer. When I got into this race, we were talking about jobs, education, priorities of infrastructure, the opioid crisis. Councillor Van Ostern has been out promoting a $300 million train that would take 2,000 people a day to work into Boston and not provide any real economic benefit to the state. Since day one, we don't have $300 million to be spending on a train to drive jobs into Boston. I want to drive jobs into New Hampshire. And you do that by focusing on the real priorities of New Hampshire's needs. So the fact that he's pivoting so quickly now that he's in a general election and he's not talking about the train as his top priority where he was before, as that economic driver that he was trying to convince people it was. The fact is, you got to make tough decisions in a leadership position, whether it's your family or your business or in public service. And those are the tough decisions I'll make. I will prioritize.
Councillor, thank you. Councillor Van Ostern, do you want to talk at all about commuter rail? I know that's been a conversation.
Absolutely.
On the trail before.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Well, I'll tell you a story about one of the reasons this is an opportunity for expanding our economy here in New Hampshire. There's a young guy named Corey who used to be an executive at Dyne, a startup tech company that now has about 400 employees in Manchester, broke off to form his own startup, which is a digital software company. They're based two stories above a startup incubator on Elm Street in Manchester. And about a year ago, he got outside investment to help them grow. The company was doing great. They had a long list of customers, and the outside investment came with a contingency. Find 4 software engineers within 90 days or move your company to Boston. Now, he found the 4th on day number 86. We talked about it throughout the summer. But the fact that that even was pushed on him is a huge concern. He told me if we had commuter rail from Boston to Nashua and Manchester, he would have had those 4 people hired in a couple weeks, and probably 2 or 3 would have ended up making their lives here in New Hampshire, where we have lower taxes, better schools, safer communities. The truth is that both an independent feasibility study has shown that commuter rail will help New Hampshire businesses grow 5,600 new jobs and develop millions of square feet of commercial real estate. And the business leaders at your colleagues, the Chambers of Commerce in Manchester and Nashua, as well as business leaders all across our state, say this is one of the tools that we need. We can't be holding ourselves back by ignoring it. One of the tools that we need to help our economy grow.
One of the most successful trains in the country is over on the east side of the state, the Downeaster. Goes right by my house every day. And the state of Maine pays $8 million a year to keep that thing running. How many jobs has that train created? And that's one of the most successful in the country. Where are the jobs being created in Exeter or Dover or Durham? Don't get me wrong, I take it all the time. It's great. I pay $17. I get to go into Boston. And I should write a thank you letter to the legislature in Maine every time I do it, because they're paying this another $17 every time we do it. So look at the reality of the jobs created by one of the most successful trains, which we already have in the state. Virtually none. I can't think of any, frankly. So again, look at the models. Look how they bear out. And by the way, that study Colin keeps referencing, you know who wrote the study? The company that's in the number one position to build the $300 million train. A massive conflict of interest. So we just got to get back to common sense here about priorities, about leadership, about doing what's right, not because Washington says so, but because the people of New Hampshire say so.
I'll be quick. I just want to point out Dover is the fastest growing city in the state of New Hampshire right now. And when you ask the mayor of Dover what she thinks about having the train stop there, she says we'd be crazy to not have passenger rail in Nashua and Manchester from Boston to help our economies there grow like it's growing in Dover.
Do you know what time the first train gets to Dover every morning from Boston? 10:30 in the morning. Nobody's getting off the train at 10:30 to go to work into Dover. I mean, you can't just say things and not understand how they work. So let's be realistic about what we plan here. To think that kids are going to get in Cambridge, get on a train and travel an hour north into Manchester every day instead of just going to work into Boston is completely unrealistic. I won't put New Hampshire's financial future at risk.
Councilor, 30-second final word.
You know, I think a governor has to bring forward solutions and bring people together to work in a New Hampshire way, not just to play politics or sit on the sidelines to try to hold ourselves back. I've done that on transportation infrastructure projects. There are bridges in Keene that are being built for half the cost of the original version because I worked with local officials and state officials to find a more efficient way to do it. I think a solution-oriented collaborative approach that listens to our state business leaders who are telling us that passenger rail is one of the things that they can use to help grow their businesses and grow our economy, that's the sort of approach that we should take for our state to help us take the next step forward.
Let's go to Doug now from AARP for a question for both, and we can start with Councillor Sununu.
Councillor Sununu, the next subject is HCBS, Home and Community-Based Services for Long-Term Care. What changes will you make to state funding of services to help more seniors live independently at home, specifically long-term care services and supports?
Well, again, I'll go back to kind of what we started doing this past year, the fact that we gave home care workers the first raise they've received in 10 years. So we can, again, incentivize more people from entering that field and maybe providing family members an opportunity to actually make some more money to give themselves the flexibility in providing better long-term care for their loved ones. We also have a nursing crisis and a nursing shortage in the state. I've sat with some of the folks on the nursing board. You know, how we licensed nurses in the state is very, very difficult. We have certain nurses that cannot get licensed. We've lost some of our nursing schools. So again, by making sure that we have the infrastructure, and by infrastructure, I mean the workforce, we're tapping into it, we're incentivizing it. Those are the things that we have to look forward to. And whether it's making sure that you're paying those workers what they should be paid, frankly, and I still think it's too low, I'd like to see them get another raise. And again, I know the current governor vetoed that budget that allowed that. I'd like to push it even further. We have to keep those incentives moving forward to keep the workers here to provide that long-term care.
Councillor, thank you. Councillor Van Ostern.
Thank you. One of the most critical parts of the network of care that we have in New Hampshire now is our service link centers all across the state. These are centers that help support home and community-based care, everything from helping provide transportation options to seniors to making sure that as they need to navigate through what can be sometimes a pretty bureaucratic maze of getting Medicaid benefits, for example, that they have the help that they need in order to do that. That has been an issue that, frankly, has been one of significant debate. During the last budget process, the legislature tried very hard to cut our service link. And as that was happening, it came to a vote in front of us on the Executive Council. It was, once again, a 3-2 vote, bipartisan support, that I joined with Republicans and Democrats to support our service link centers. In fact, there are seniors right now today, somewhere in New Hampshire, who are getting that sort of home and community-based support under those service link contracts. I was proud to vote for it. I was disappointed that Chris voted against it. I think that that is the sort of vote that holds our state back, and I think that we can do better than that, and we need to make sure that things like Service Link get the support that they need to help support home and community-based care for our citizens.
Councillor, thank you. Gentlemen, thank you for your questions. I'd like to transition now to some of the audience questions that we have, and you can each have a minute to respond.
I'll ask. Just to be clear, I never voted against the Service Link contract. What?
It was on May 6th of last year. It was about a mile from here in the State House, and it was a 3-2 vote. Might have been May 7th, okay, whichever
we'll
Wednesday.
We'll do a fact check.
We'll double check that afterwards. I'd like to transition to questions that many of you wrote and submitted, and I want to thank you in advance. This is actually a topic that both of you have referenced, but it's a very important one to the state of New Hampshire, to many families, and that is our impending heroin drug crisis. Could each of you just spell out the immediate first steps that you might be taking as governor to help not with just law enforcement and dealing with the crackdown on supply, but in expanding the pipeline of treatment? Councillor Sununu, you may go first.
Real action. That is what this state needs. Now, we've done some very good things in this state, to be sure. I think the fact that we have millions of dollars still tied up in Concord that hasn't been put onto the streets, that hasn't been put into quality programs, is incredibly frustrating. Get the money out, get the resources out. I think the fact that we have programs in the state that have success, whether it's in recovery or prevention, but we don't fund them for certain reasons, we make it too complex for them to apply for that funding, that's terrible. We need to open it up and simplify the process. You have to understand whether you're talking about the drug crisis or health care or just, you know, getting a dock built on a pond. We make things so difficult in this state for the average citizen, whether it's a grant, applying for funds, or knowing what resources we have available. I'm a big believer in aggressive prevention in schools, partly because I have kids. Look, as a parent, I have a fifth and a sixth grader. And the fact is that my son will likely be offered pills or drugs or God knows what in the next couple years. And that's a hard conversation to have as a parent. But that's reality. I want aggressive prevention in school starting in the fifth grade. And my program brings the parents into those programs and make sure that they know the tools and resources available to them so we can all become more educated and understand what resources we have going forward. This won't be turned over in a day, but we have to start pushing hard on real programs for real solutions.
Councillor, thank you. Councillor Van Ostern.
I know that we are going to overcome this crisis and that we're going to do it together. We have to realize that doing that means attacking the problem, not the people with the problem. Many of us have had a family member or a loved one who has suffered from the trap of addiction. And I know that it'll take more investments in treatment, prevention, and recovery in order to do that. There's a great nonpartisan nonprofit called New Futures, which just after the primary, I sat down last week with law enforcement, the individuals in addiction recovery themselves, counselors at New Futures, to talk about not what politicians' plans are, though you know you can check out each of our plans on this crisis on our websites, but to hear from them about what their plan is. From a nonpartisan perspective, what can we do to bring people together to overcome the crisis? They said there are five things. Fully fund the state alcohol fund, make the New Hampshire Health Protection Plan permanent so that the thousands of our fellow citizens who are getting treatment services can continue to do that. Third, strengthen our workforce, particularly for those who are on the treatment and recovery end of this. Fourth, remove barriers to treatment. Too many times, even those with private insurance aren't getting access to the treatment because there are complications or bureaucracy or red tape with the payment structures. And then finally, do a better job of making sure that we have age-appropriate, evidence-based prevention. I support and endorse their plan. And I think that is the sort of plan that we need to move forward, and it's one of the big decisions voters will have in this race.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Our next question is now a localized one, but one that has an impact very much on the capital region. As we all know, there is the men's prison in Concord right up the road from here, and soon there will be a newly constructed women's prison as well. The city will be the receiver, the recipients of the of folks as they are released from both the male and men's and women's prison. What do you see as your role and as the state's role to mitigate potential negative impact on the local community? Councilor Van Ostern first.
Thanks for the question. I've thought about it a lot as an executive councilor for the Concord area. And our next governor has a responsibility to do what's right for all the people of New Hampshire here, not just one particular community. The truth is that being the center of our state government has a lot of benefits and a lot of challenges for the city of Concord. I think that the city and the state have mainly been great partners to each other and that we've succeeded as a community because of that. But as we take on new challenges like expanding significantly our prison here in Concord, we need to make sure that there are the resources also for the local community to deal with some of those costs as well. I've seen how this has worked successfully where there was an effort by the state to move the courthouse up to the Heights in Concord. And it was local voices who came forward and said, here's what we need to keep it locally downtown. Business leaders, county officials, city officials. So I'll make sure that our city and county officials in Concord have a clear voice in the future of not just the construction project, but also the ensuing halfway houses and where folks who are leaving the prison start. And frankly, it's different for men and women. Women tend to go back to their home communities when they're released. They have more likely to have family connections. Men tend to be a little more mobile and tend to have less family connections. So we need to take that understanding and make sure that city and county officials have a voice in that process.
Thank you, Councilor. Mm-hmm. Councilor Sununu, you have 90 seconds.
Thank you. This is an issue. Not just for Concord, we are building the new prison here, but please remember we have county jails all over the state as well. One of the biggest problems I see within our prison system, frankly, is the drugs. If you think there are not drugs in our jails, you're missing a bigger picture here. They are in our jails. When I sat with a county commissioner and he told me how a prisoner was transferred from one county to the next, and I won't say which for disclosure reasons, and that prisoner showed up high after being in jail for a week, but he showed up to the new county high. This is a real problem, a real problem. So first and foremost, we need to make sure that those that are being locked up are getting the treatment that they need, that we are doing what we can to make sure we get those drugs out of jail, that we're putting job training programs within those facilities. A lot of folks, when they come out, they want to get back to normal society. They want a job. Their biggest fear is knowing that they can't get back into the workforce because they now have a criminal record and a history. So we need to make sure we're providing them resources within that system. So when they come out, they're assimilating back in, they're getting a job, they're assimilating back with family if that's what it needs to be. And hopefully, again, they're not just going back to the drugs or the issue that likely put them there in the first place.
Councilors, thank you. Our next question. Would you have signed or vetoed the right to work bill that recently passed the House of Representatives? Councilor Sununu.
I think I would have signed it, yeah.
Councilor Van Ostern.
I would have vetoed it. If you look at states that have done that, they tend to have among the lowest wages in the country, and I think we need to do what we can to boost wages here in New Hampshire.
Our next question. Councilor Van Ostern, you can go first. What will you do to bring in and develop high technology business here in New Hampshire?
Well, we've talked a little bit about some of the ways we can do that, expanding access to rural broadband, bringing passenger rail that'll help the tech companies that are here grow and grow faster. A lot of this does come down to our workforce. Frankly, you know, we talked earlier about college education and what we can do to strengthen college education in New Hampshire. Bringing and keeping young people and young families and new businesses and startups in our state is perhaps the most important long-term challenge that we are facing here in New Hampshire. And I don't say long-term because it's not urgent. It's urgent too, but it's not something that we can deal with in a week or 2 weeks. So bringing down the cost of college, not just dealing with student loans, but bringing down the cost itself is absolutely critical. We need to have funding for a university system which comes with accountability measures so that as additional funding is promised, we are ensuring that more folks are graduating with lower student debt. That'll allow them to stay here in New Hampshire. Think about the following. Right now, our high school students leave our state when they graduate from high school faster than any state in the country except New Jersey when they're seeking college. It's not a coincidence because our college in-state tuition is the highest in the country. And our student debt levels are the highest in the country. So doing more to bring and keep young people and young families here is, when our unemployment is as low as it is, it's an absolutely dire need for strengthening our workforce and helping our tech sector grow.
Councilor Sununu.
Yeah, so a couple things. As someone who has a business in the North Country, I agree. We have we can do much better when it comes to our internet infrastructure. High tech companies are not going to come here if you can't provide that that internet superhighway for them to do business. And it's not just in Concord, and it's not just in Manchester. It is all across this state. We do need to reduce the cost of college. My program's real. The next $5 million we put into the university system under my plan will lower college tuition, $1,000 for 5,000 students. Make it real. Don't put the money into more administrative costs or some of the costs we've seen the university spending on it. Let's make these savings real for these families. We've talked about the incentive programs that I'd like to see as students come out of the university system, cutting down their student debt, investing into helping them pay down that student debt when they stay here. How about computer science skills, real programming skills, not just in community college, but at the high school level, frankly, at the junior high level. We need to give these kids the skills they need and frankly want and are looking for as early as we can. And it doesn't just start in college, it starts at 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. By investing in those programs, we can retain them, we can incentivize them, and we can grow our tech sector.
I'd like to build on something Chris said, and
yes,
it sounds like it's an area where I think we could agree on. You know, New Hampshire should ensure that every high school student should have the option of learning computer programming courses. That is the sort of thing that will help power our economy as we move forward. I remember when I was at Stonyfield, you'd hire a new executive and they'd go through the job interview process and then you'd take them out to dinner and they'd have the real discussion about whether or not to take the job. Always the first question is, how are the schools? You know, which community should they live in? Do they offer full-day public kindergarten? Do they have great schools? Making investments like that are the sort of thing that we can do to make sure that our economy thrives, and not just for the kids, but for their parents who, you know, are deciding where they're going to live and make their lives.
See, we can get along too, huh? Pretty good. Next question. Councilor Sununu, given that approximately half of the state's entire budget is through the Department of Health and Human Services, what would be your top three priorities within that department?
Well, you know, something that I've always wanted to entertain is should we break that department up? Not in a negative way, but to make it, I'm an engineer. I'm all about making systems more efficient. When you make systems more efficient, you have more money left over for more quality programs. That's the benefit of, and sometimes it's tough to say no to things, but that's the benefit of saying, cutting out the bad so you can make sure you're doing the good things even better. I think HHS works fairly well. I'm very concerned over the fact that we have such a high turnover rate in the last 6 months at the executive leadership level of that department. A lot of turnover. One of the folks, I won't say the name, but one of the folks that I will be interviewing on tomorrow, actually, for the deputy commissioner position currently runs a nursing home, one of our nursing home facilities, which I like. That's the type of experience we need in there. But maybe as we've grown all these giant federal programs, right? To be blunt, the Democrats have let these giant federal Washington programs come into the state. They've pushed to make them permanent, so we've lost our leverage. That's the driver in most of Health and Human Services. Should we look at a solution where we take state programs to one side and the massive federal government programs to another? Should we look at breaking up, making it more efficient? There are also programs in there where, again, I think there's a lot of redundancy and crossover, where I think we could simply be much more efficient with how we spend those dollars.
Councilor, thank you. Councilor Van Ostern. Ostern, top three priorities in HHS?
Sure. Well, I get to go second, so I had the time to write down three. So one, which we've talked about a lot today, but it's important, it's one of the highest priorities for our business community across our state and for healthcare in our state, is continue the successful bipartisan New Hampshire Health Protection Plan. That means care for tens of thousands of our citizens and resources for the drug crisis that we absolutely have to overcome. Second, specifically on the drug crisis, we have started to make some strides around things like a prescription drug monitoring program. Part of prevention is prevention in schools, but part of it is making sure that we're making sure our healthcare practitioners have the tools that they need so that folks aren't getting hooked on painkillers in the first place. 4 out of 5 individuals on heroin started with prescription pain pills. And a good prescription drug monitoring program is a really critical tool that's just ramping up now. It needs to be a top priority. And then third, it sounds small, but it's important. And when I talk about cutting red tape and finding new efficiencies in state government, here's an example. We need to move to a fully digital paperless contracting system that'll be better for small businesses that do work with the state. It'll mean more efficiency, less state dollars that's spent on things like paperwork and staff time, so that the dollars that we do spend can be efficient and can be focused on helping our fellow citizens.
Thank you, councilors. Next question. New Hampshire's unemployment rate is low. Median income is up. New Hampshire workers of all ages are moving out of state for better pay. What will you do to raise salaries and pay levels in New Hampshire, including some livable minimum wage? Councilor Van Ostern, I'll start with you first.
Well, I do believe that New Hampshire can no longer have the lowest in the nation minimum wage. Right now, it's $7.25 an hour, only because that's what our national minimum wage is. To be clear, we have one candidate running for president who thinks we should have no national minimum wage. If that happened, we'd have no minimum wage at all in New Hampshire. We will succeed as a state when we make sure that folks have the money in their pockets to power New Hampshire businesses, that we're not spending public welfare dollars on individuals who are working full-time but earning so few dollars that they're relying on public assistance as well. So I think we need a higher New Hampshire minimum wage. I think we should start by having a state minimum wage, which we have none of right now. And you know, that'll be up to our next governor and our next legislature, but I know that it's the right thing to do to strengthen our economy.
Councilor, thank you. Councilor Sununu?
Yeah. I have 800 employees, about 3-5%, because we have some restaurants. Folks get paid minimum wage. If we do what Councilor Van Ostern does, increase minimum wage, which he talked about yesterday, to $12, increase it 75%, the trickle-up effect, it would be absolutely devastating to businesses. I don't mind increasing the minimum wage. We defer to the federal minimum wage right now. We have for quite a long time. It works very well for our businesses. If you're not in the business world in 2016, if you're not managing businesses and having the responsibility of signing those paychecks and the responsibility of making sure that those employees have the ability they need to take care of their family, you don't understand the impact that something like that would be to businesses in the state. It would be devastating to go to a $12 minimum wage right now. Increasing it over time, sure. We defer to the federal minimum wage. It has done very well for us, and I support in maintaining that.
I'd just like to make a factual correction. I've suggested that raising the minimum wage will be a negotiation between our next governor and our next legislature. There's a bill right now to raise it to $12 an hour. I think that's a good place to start the negotiation. But if you're somewhere between $7.25 and $12, that doesn't equal $12. You know, I think that'll be up to a negotiation between our next governor and the next legislature. To defend having the lowest minimum wage in the nation is to hold our state back. We're never going to be Texas. You know, we have certain competitive advantages to every other state, and they include a high quality of life, low taxes, and a well-trained, well-educated workforce. We are not going to have the cheapest labor force in the country. We shouldn't compete to have more people on minimum wage than other states the way a state like Texas does. Now, that might be right for their economy, but it's not right for New Hampshire. I know that we can look out for the bottom line and still look out for people, and that does not include having the lowest in the nation minimum wage, and it does not include having no minimum wage, which could likely happen depending on how this next election goes.
Again, you know, that is an example of someone who doesn't understand what the true impacts will be. To say that we're going to land somewhere in a gray area between $7 and $12, that's a really big gray area. And I can tell you a lot of business owners in this state, their hair just went up on the back of their neck. Talk about the uncertainty of that. I mean, it's appalling to me to stand here and say, yesterday saying you want to start at $12, start at $12 like Hillary Clinton does, would be devastating. And when we were asked about a similar issue yesterday, about Obama's new rule, not a piece of legislation, but a new rule that changes how we do overtime, Councilor Van Ostern had no response. Again, another example of Washington mandates and regulation that is driving business out of this state. We have to do things better. We have to do it our way. And the best way to do that is with someone that is living and breathing these issues every single day, understands the impacts not just to the businesses, but to the families, to the individuals that these policies will have the most impact on.
I just want to point out the irony of somebody saying we should not do it the Washington way, but then says that the minimum wage should be whatever Washington says it is. Mm-hmm.
Final question before we move to closing statements. And Councillor Van Ostern, we will start with you. What is your plan or your vision to utilize one of the strengths of the Granite State, our state's aging population?
Yeah. I mentioned this in my opening statement. I think one of the ways our economy is going to succeed as we age is by making sure everyone at every age and stage of life can participate in our communities and our economy. I'll give you a specific story and then an insight that I learned recently a few weeks ago. The story is my father-in-law, my wife's dad, who's in his 70s, who's well retired and is now going back to school here in Concord at the Tech to get a licensed drug and alcohol counseling degree so he can counsel others in the midst of this crisis. He's not going to do it full time, but it's an experience he has from his own life that matters, and he knows that that's one of the ways that he will find fulfillment and rewarding time in his retirement. Now, here's the story and why it matters. A couple weeks ago, we sat down with the governor and council, sat down with the head of nursing at Colby Sawyer College to learn about the nursing shortage in our state. And she said, part of the problem isn't just that you need to recruit more young nurses. Part of the problem is that as they start, it's a difficult job, and if they don't have mentorship and they don't have faculty members, as our faculty members often are aging out of the workforce, then you can't actually have a sustainable nursing model in our state. And so I think folks who are retired or partly retired should be connected with mentorship opportunities with young workers, faculty positions, particularly in areas of workforce need. Everyone needs to be part of making sure our state succeeds. And having everyone from every age and stage participate in the next step in our state's future is the only way that it's going to work.
Councilor, thank you. Councilor Sununu, what is your plan or your vision to utilize the strengths of the Granite State, one of our strengths, our aging population?
Again, to touch upon some things we talked about. As our population is aged, we have high property taxes in this state. That's, I believe in local control, but we do have the reality of high property taxes, which means more and more folks get on fixed incomes, they have less financial flexibility. I'd like to increase the waiver we essentially give, the exemption we give, on the first dollars on the interest and dividends tax. We need to provide those seniors and those individuals the ability to handle things like high property tax. I want a long-term energy plan in this state when our energy utility costs are some of the highest in the country. That is driving seniors out. That is limiting their ability to stay in their homes or maintain the lifestyle and quality of life that we cherish here in this state. So whether it's Northern Pass or more natural gas, really promoting the best renewable projects the state has to offer and having the expertise and experience to make those decisions. Again, it's all about providing more individual income to those folks so they have financial flexibility. And then finally, we touched upon a little bit, making sure that we keep increasing the wages for those who can provide long-term home care. We know we are going to get better care with individualized attention in the home as opposed to just dumping folks into a nursing home. That is never a better answer. So again, making sure that we do it the New Hampshire way, we keep things local, and we maintain that financial flexibility for seniors.
Councilors, thank you. We'll move now to closing statements. And just before I do, I want to once again thank Doug Dowell from AARP, Phil Hastings today representing the chamber for your questions. Thanks to all of you for being here. And we'll call up Todd Fahey for some final thoughts in just a moment. But we'll move to closing remarks. And by coin flip, Councilor Van Ostern, you may go first. You have 2 minutes, sir.
Thank you, Scott. And thanks, everybody, for coming. I really appreciate the opportunity. And thank you, Chris. I've enjoyed the discussion that we've had. We're figuring out as a state now how we're going to take our next step forward. And partly I wanted to say thank you to those of you in this room who have played such an active role in making this the best place in the country to live and work and raise a family and grow a business. My wife and I have seen that here for our sons and the businesses that we've worked in, and it's incredibly important. You know, I was raised by a single mom, and we moved around a lot. When I went to college, I worked two part-time jobs and went to college on student loans, and I know I never would have had that opportunity, nor would have I had the opportunity to be in front of you today talking about how we can invest in our state's future, except for a lot of other people working hard to make it possible. I know that as we look out for the bottom line, we can still look out for people too. And I know how New Hampshire has been able to make progress in recent years. We're not perfect, but look at the national reality show of a presidential campaign we're in the middle of. Look at how broken Washington is. Look at where you get when all you do is point fingers and blame the other party for things. I think that we can find ways to move together by working together. We need an efficient state government with less red tape. I know we can do it with no sales tax and no income tax. And I know we need to invest in bringing and keeping our young people and young families and new businesses and startups here. And I know that that's how we've made progress, whether it's the New Hampshire Health Protection Plan or investments in clean and renewable energy projects. Neither of those happened because one party had a monopoly on all the good ideas. They were the product of compromise and cooperation, finding ways to work together. That's how New Hampshire has moved into the future. That's how we are going to take our next step forward. And as a dad, as a business leader, and as someone who's represented this great community for the 4 years that we've had up until now, I'm here to ask for your help and support in this race so we can take our next step forward as a state. Thank you very much.
Councilor, thank you. Councilor Sununu, you have 2 minutes, sir.
And thanks, everyone, for coming out today. I thought it was a great discussion, lively discussion. We do very well in New Hampshire, but we have to do better, and we need some changes. We really do, and it starts in the corner office. We have not had a governor in the corner office that has the experience, that has the firsthand knowledge of truly how a lot of these policies we talk about, all these things we talk about, how they're impacting people's lives. I talk a lot about education. My wife was a special ed teacher. She went back to, she grew up in the inner city in Chelsea. She went back and taught in those schools. We have kids in schools. We've homeschooled. We've been in public schools. We got waitlisted at charter schools. We've walked the school choice path here in this state, and I believe we need to enhance that because we limit school choice. And I believe that education is the fundamental foundation for so much in what we do in this state. I believe we need a governor in the corner office that is dealing with these issues today. Not simply as matters of policy in Concord, but as actually living and breathing these issues today. The fact that we have the highest healthcare costs in the country, yet people talk about how we're one of the healthiest states. What have the governors done in the past 10 years to really address that? That is keeping us from growing our economy. That is keeping us from growing business. I have experience with it. I deal with it every single day. I don't believe the Washington answers are right for us. I don't. Colin Van Ostern wants to expand Washington's control over healthcare by making their programs permanent. He wants to expand Washington's control over our schools by promoting and enhancing Common Core. He wants to expand Washington's control over our infrastructure with this giant Washington-promoted rail project. I simply want to get back to doing it the New Hampshire way. I bring the, and whether it's my experience in the environmental field, experience with my business in tourism, growing up in Salem, living on the seacoast, having a business in the White Mountains, we need a governor that understands how what we do in Concord impacts everyone regionally, across this state, because we're so different. And we need that experience to move our state forward, to bring the change that is so important into making sure we're competitive in the 21st century. Thank you guys for coming out. I hope to earn your support. I hope to earn your vote. Give us a call. Get involved with the campaign. Ask the questions. And again, together, we can definitely make some changes for New Hampshire for the future. Appreciate it.
Councilors, thank you very much for your time and your passion. And before we go, I'd like to bring up Todd Fahey for one final parting word. Todd?
Well, a sincere thank you to our partner, the Concord Chamber, and for Councilor Van Ostern and for Councilor Sununu for coming today. Thank you for that vibrant and vigorous policy discussion. And to our panelists for your excellent questions. We appreciate it very much. You know, we work best when we talk about issues and we talk about them in a very authentic and open way like we did today. So I thank you all for coming. We'll be back here again October 4th with the race for the second congressional district, again with the Concord Chamber. So thank you all very much for coming. Have a great afternoon. Thanks.